Hey guys, welcome back to another video. This is Motivation for Young Christians. Welcome back to another episode of Bible Study. This is Bible Study episode 52. Today we're going to dive into Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. We're going to be talking about the promise of the Holy Spirit and the ascension of Jesus. Today we have Brother John with us in this episode of Bible Study to be able to discuss the words for iron to be able to sharpen iron. And to begin, we're going to start off with a prayer by me. We're going to be led today by Brother John. And the ending prayer will be by Brother John. Without further ado, if you guys can, please bow your heads and close your eyes. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We praise you. We worship you, God. We thank you for this day that you've made. I rejoice in God, God. I pray now as we came together, God, for iron to be able to sharpen iron, God, to be able to discuss your word, God. We pray that your hands will bless and cover the word, God. We pray that you'll be able to reveal to us the information that we are needed on us to know, God. We pray that we'll be able to discuss, God, and continue to learn, God, to learn all the important information, God, to continue on our journey of Christian, God, to be able to continue to learn, to be able to continue to grow, God. We love you and we thank you, God. We pray that you be with us today, God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. All right, so our scripture today is Acts chapter 1. Verse 1 through 11, I'll read in the New Living Translation. All right. So in my first book, I told you, Theophilus, about everything Jesus began to do and teach until the day he was taken up to heaven after giving his chosen apostles further instructions through the Holy Spirit. During the 40 days after he suffered and died, he appeared to the apostles from time to time, and he proved to them in many ways that he was actually alive. And he talked to them about the kingdom of God. Once, when he was eating with them, he commanded them, "Do not leave Jerusalem until the Father sends you the gift he promised, as I told you before. John baptized you with water, but in just a few days, you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." So when the apostles were with Jesus, they kept asking him, "Lord, has the time come for you to free Israel and restore our kingdom?" He replied, "The Father alone has the authority to set those dates and times, and they are not for you to know. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and the ends of the world." After saying this, he was taken up into a cloud while they were watching, and they could no longer see him. As they strained to see him rising into heaven, two white-robed men suddenly stood among them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why are you standing here staring into heaven? Jesus has been taken from you into heaven, but someday he will return from heaven in the same way you saw him go." Thus ends the reading of today's designation for his holy word.
Amen. Amen. In the scripture, I always love how Jesus always made them aware of what was going to happen, even though they at times didn't understand it.
Jesus was not a secret person. You've heard me even say on the Bible study a couple of times. Jesus was a real G. He was a real person. Really good with people. He knew how to keep you in the loop and keep you at a place that you wanted to at least know what he was speaking about. Even through the parables. If he said something, he wasn't afraid to come back around and say what he was saying. He was a master teacher, a master HR person, and he just knew how to bring you on the journey with him. That's what makes me love Jesus. It makes you not just want to, not necessarily know him, but know that you can walk with him and he will walk with you. So I was like that. But, all right. So you gotta remember, at least for the first part, Luke wrote this book. Luke, same from the Gospel of Luke, he actually continued to write this, the account here, and still telling of the Gospel, still going in addition to it in the overall collective. It's not that each came one by one. It's not like, okay, Matthew wrote first, Mark, Luke, and John. It's just the way everything is collected. What I love about the first part, at least, is definitely verse 2. "Until the day he was taken up to heaven after after giving his chosen apostles further instructions through the Holy Spirit." Even this weekend, Ezra, I'm not even sure if you even realize, the way that things just fall into line. So we record this on Saturday. Tomorrow actually is Pentecost Sunday. So tomorrow actually is the Feast of Pentecost, the day that we normally celebrate the empowering of the Holy Spirit to the church. So how fitting that the day before we get there, we talk about he who is the Holy Spirit for a little bit. One thing I do want to actually, I guess, hit on that jumps out through the scripture, as I said in verse 2, and kind of in a way kind of debunks a myth that we hear in the church, or it depends on which church you come from, is actually the Holy Spirit's presence itself. Many attribute Pentecost to being the day that the Holy Spirit appeared. The Holy Spirit, even though it was a day that believers were empowered, he was always in existence. He was always present. And even we see here in the scripture, and I love it very plainly put, that the Lord gave instructions to the apostles through the Holy Spirit. So Holy Spirit is who spoke through the Lord to give divine instructions for how they would be introduced to the Holy Spirit in a different way. The Holy Spirit has always existed. He has always been in play, quote unquote. Remember, even before this particular scripture, we see when Jesus was baptized, the Holy Spirit was manifested as a dove. That's why so many times you see in churches, you see the dove. It's really supposed to be a symbolic of he who is the Holy Spirit. And so with that, we saw in the scripture here, the Lord told them, wait, hold on. And as they did, they waited, and they waited in the power of the Holy Spirit. And it's really all just to put everything together, because you see also too, in verse 3, it goes through, it's like during those 40 days after the Lord resurrected, that whole time period, he made different appearances from time to time to kind of say, hey, I did what I said I would do. I told you, you destroy this body. 3 days later, I'm going to wake up again. And in that time period, he moved. He still did miracles. He still appeared to people. And now is to get into the place now. He sets the stage for when he goes back to the Father. And now he gives us something that will be the eternal helper until that time comes again that he comes back for us. And that's going to be the Holy Spirit. I mean, in John, we talked about the Holy Spirit, that he's a helper, a teacher, an advocate. And it sets it up. It sets it up for a glorious day for us who are the church.
And it definitely does.
What you got? What jumped out to you, sir?
Jumped out to me. I'm going to verses 4, which says, once when he was eaten with them, he commanded to them, do not leave Jerusalem until the Father sent the gift I promised you, as I told you before. And it was very important for the Holy Spirit to come. I believe that's what they're talking about by the gift, right? The Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. Okay. It's very important for the Holy Spirit to come, because now we have Jesus in a different form. Because before, they had Jesus in the physical form, but he'd no longer be here after resurrection. He got to go back up to heaven, not only the clouds, but to heaven. Just wanted to make sure we have that clarification. And now with him being gone, we have the Holy Spirit to do the job of Jesus, to do the work of us, and to be able to help us and guide us. And I just wanted to just point that out, because I was very like key something that pointed out to my head.
It's true. So the Lord went back into heavens, and the promise was given to us that we can walk. I mean, you actually hit on the point that I was thinking of, but didn't want to bring out, at least then, is that, you know, sometimes the question would be, I think sometimes when we think about the apostles and those back then, they had a different walk. At least for those that walked with Jesus. I mean, what happens now as thousands of years have passed? And, you know, of course, we still love Jesus. We still worship Jesus. We still learn and give our hearts to the Lord. But it's kind of like, well, how can I walk with the Lord? And the answer is simply the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit was given to us to help us walk this walk. Depending on what reformation you come from, many believe the Father is Jesus, and of course the Son is Jesus, and the Holy Ghost is Jesus. And then a way we can say the Holy Spirit is Jesus's representation with us on the day to day. And not only that too, still in the package in that particular section. It even confirms what was prophesied from even John the Baptist. You know, verse 5 says, John baptized with water, but in just a few days you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit. And really is, when it's saying being baptized with the Holy Spirit, I mean you're being baptized into the Spirit of God. Because even if you go into 1 Corinthians and forward, the word tells us that we actually can't even be saved unless we're drawn by the Spirit. The Holy Spirit is a great person who works within us in this day. It's not working that is just with the outer manifestations. I know a lot of times, at least for our, you know, we come from a Pentecostal Reformation. We emphasize, you know, the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the emphasis on tongues. But there's more so to that. It's not just the tongues, but it's really the emphasis on being baptized means you're being identified with the Holy Spirit. You're being baptized, you're being identified and put into a place of a different relationship. And that's where we want to really get to. It's not just being a touch or having the impartation of him that manifests in your body. It's about really being in him and him being in you. When you, we talk about even water baptism, we're immersed in the water. And that's really what it's talking about. Be immersed in the Holy Spirit that you're able to walk. So because there's an old church saying, not even the prophecy saying, but it's an old church saying, you got to have it done in your heart first when you get in the water, because you can always go down the dry devil and come up a wet devil. And if you're not careful, you could be a demon tongue talker before you get filled. And if you're not careful, we're not transformed in your heart, you'll be a demon filled tongue talker afterwards. So it's about being baptized in him and really knowing the Holy Spirit. I feel like I'm preaching my sermon tomorrow before I get there, but it's really about knowing the Holy Spirit, right? You must have a relationship with him. And that's something we have to emphasize as well. That was a gift to us. It's a promise from the Father. It was foretold that we would have this opportunity to know he, the Holy Spirit. And I always like to make sure I emphasize that the Holy Spirit is not an it. We cannot say that, oh, I felt it. That's not, you know, the Holy Spirit, I'm going to say, quote unquote, in that particular case. You're feeling the presence of God. You're feeling the presence of the Holy Spirit. But the Holy Spirit is a person. And we have to get to the place that we know the Father as a person. And of course, in spirit, we must know Jesus as a person and in spirit. And we must know the Holy Spirit as a person and in spirit as well.
Amen. It's not only important to know what the Holy Spirit do, but it's important to know who the Holy Spirit is. You always have to emphasize that it's important to know who the Holy Spirit is. And going to verses 6 and 7, I just wanted to point out that Jesus is in control. He's in control. He is the authority. He set days. He's allowed this to happen and that happen. And sometimes we tend to forget that we tend to forget that God is in control. And I like the fact that Jesus pointed that out to his disciples.
And it also even shows, to even jumping on that, even how the Trinity or the Triune God, however Reformation you come from, how they work together. The Holy Spirit reveals Jesus. Jesus reveals the Father. The Father is the creator and God of all. So all things point, of course, for us, because remember our connection to the Father, what makes us able to call him Abba Father, what able makes us Daddy God, is that we have come through his Son. How do we come through his Son? The Holy Spirit reveals his Son to us. So all of this is to help us be reconciled to the Father. And like I said, it goes to show the authority of the Father. The Father alone has the authority of knowing the dates and times, just like it says. And we don't know these things, but what we know is we trust he who knows, and we trust he who reveals. And that's one of the great things about the Holy Spirit as well. He reveals to us Jesus. He reveals his person. He reveals how he loves us, how he cares for us, how we can live to please the Lord as we please the Father. And in that, we might not know when the Lord is coming. We might not know when the Lord is going to crack the sky again, but we know that he has the authority. Historically, even, let's see, what's today? Today is May 22nd, 2021, the day of this particular recording. Yesterday, May 21st, Ezra, I'm gonna have an Ezra moment. So 10 years ago, when you were way too small to realize what was going on in the world, you young people, 10 years ago, there was actually a very famous Bible teacher. I'm not gonna say his name, just gonna let those that know, or you can Google it. He actually said 10 years ago that the Lord was going to come back on May 21st, 2011. And the thing was, in that particular day, 10 years ago, there was a whole big hubbub. People began to sell their houses. People began to give away their possessions. People just quit their jobs. All these different things because this preacher told them that on May 21st, 2011, the rapture was going to happen. The Lord was going to crack the sky. And the thing is, and even I bring it back here to the word tells us we do not know when the Lord is going to come. But what we do know through the Holy Spirit, he's coming again. And the main thing is be ready and realize too. I mean, sometimes you never know. Sometimes maybe God had in his heart originally that he would come that day. We don't know, but because we think we know him to the place that we can tell God what he's going to do, when he's going to do it, he shows sovereignty and he shows ultimate control. But we have to know the Holy Spirit and we have to know what to wait and how to wait. Even going with that, after the Lord says that the Father has authority over all things, he tells them to wait. And as they wait, he lets them know that as you wait, you're going to receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And the thing is this. So the Holy Spirit is coming upon you. What is it for you to do? And here's the thing, mainly when it comes to why do we need the Holy Spirit and what does he do in our lives? I always love Acts 1:8, not necessarily for the power aspect, but for the application aspect. You can always have power. We all have power, believe it or not. If you are a believer, according to Mark 16, at the end 16 through 18, you have power. You are able to speak in unknown languages. You're able to lay hands on the sick and see them healed. You're able to cast out devils. All these things happen because you have power. That just comes with the nature of who we are as believers. With that, but now we go into the place of application. How do you apply this power that you have through the Holy Spirit? You do that by becoming a witness. You're telling people about me everywhere, like the word says, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea and Samaria, and the ends of the earth. So the Lord is saying here, there's been a promise to you that you would be not just empowered, but you'll be empowered to apply this power to the world that is around you. I'm giving you something. I'm giving you someone that will walk with you, that you'll be able to apply my teachings. I'm giving you someone that you'll be able to apply my principles. I'm giving you someone that will empower you to be able to go and be me in this world. We as believers, we're ambassadors of Christ. We're the salt and light of Christ. We are, I don't want to say we are Jesus, but we're many Jesus prototypes to the world that is around us. And what we do is we take this power that was within Jesus. We walk in this authority that is within Jesus that's given to us through the Holy Spirit. And with that, we're able to go and impact and empower the world because the Holy Spirit was given to us that we would be here to be the foot and the hands and the mouthpieces and the eyes and all these different things of the body of Christ in the world today. I'm a hush.
Amen. 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 I also very much agree on that point. And I was writing down my notes as you were talking about it, John. We as the people, once God revealed himself to us, once we have the knowledge, once we received the teaching, now it's our job to go out and teach others. It's our job to go out and spread the word. Like how bad news spread like fire, we got to spread the good news of God like fire. We got to spread it because that's our very much job. And every single day, I'm thankful that I have my platform. I'm thankful for my gifts because I'm able to directly do that. I'm able to record a video, and anybody around the world, if you got Wi-Fi, you can see me. So I'm thankful for the position I'm in because I'm able to spread the good news of God. And as I'm learning, as I'm going, as I'm working on myself and just more on me, I continue to learn. I continue to educate my people as I go. So I just wanted to make that note for verse 8.
Yes. And it makes me think of, you know what? It makes me think of, actually, I have to make sure I write this down because this is a weird imagery. It makes me think about batteries. So, man, and I don't have a battery immediately near me. But you ever seen a battery? Like a AAA, AA? Yes. It's funny. As soon as you said like a remote. All right. So on the Ezron, take a look on it. Let's see if they still have it. There should be a date on there.
Yes, it's March 2025.
Okay. So the one I have here for my mouse that I'm sitting there has a date of March 2030. Oh. In essence, here's an image to think about, even when you think about the Holy Spirit. So what it's pretty much saying is, at least when it comes to batteries, so batteries were manufactured to carry power. And the power itself has one purpose: to be applied and let that power that's within it be dispersed. But what happens if the date on your battery comes and the battery has not been used? The power expires. It begins to disintegrate. Matter of fact, even day by day, after the battery is even made, it begins to lose its power because it's just sitting there. This is an imagery and a challenge to us as believers. Do not be a sitting battery.
I was trying to while you talking, I was just trying to show the audience that. Mm-hmm.
Checking out too. What happens is this power has to be applied. Matter of fact, I'll even use my mouse here. The only reason why this mouse is able to be used for the purpose of which it was created was because the power that was needed was applied to it. This world is like a mouse. This world is like a mouse or a remote or whatever other device. The only reason or the only way it's actually able to do effectively what it needs to do is once you apply the power to it. Here's a challenge for us as believers in reading this word today. We cannot be believers that just receive the Holy Spirit or sit with power within us and not allow that power or that battery to be applied. We as believers have been meant and designed to be applied, to bring power and let power be applied. We are meant to be applied power in this world. What is within you was not meant to sit in you and die. What was put in you, your gifts, your talents, your abilities, all that the Holy Spirit has enabled you to do, was not meant to sit inside of you and reach a shelf date of which it begins to disintegrate. But we must begin to allow the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, to begin to teach us and guide us and say, Holy Spirit, apply me as a battery where I need to be and let your power be dissipated and dispersed where it needs to go. That's going to cost you 50 cents. Send my Cash App. Nah, not at all. But that was just on my heart when I thought about that.
But it is such a very wonderful thought, because we are like batteries, because I say that our body is this remote, and mm-hmm. then the word of God is the battery.
Yes,
and is. Once the battery goes in the remote, now you're able to turn on the TV. But in the spiritual sense, you're able to receive the spiritual teaching, the spiritual word of God. And I say switching the channels is like delivering the word, because it got a whole bunch of channels on the TV and it got a whole bunch of people on this earth that need to receive the information from God.
Man, the imagery.
About to make me start something today.
Come on now. Take the word and run with it.
That's what we have to do as children of God. Take the word and run with it.
And here's the fun part. I always love about this scripture. I always, you know, I mean, for those that watch episodes I've been on with Ezra, I know that I'm just very picturistic. I just run with a very vivid imagination. So the Lord just drops these nuggets on them. And, you know, he's like, all right, you're going to have the Holy Spirit. You're going to have power and you're going to go be witnesses. And not even like the Lord said, bye, quote unquote. The Lord drops this last nugget, and I love it. And I love that he didn't say goodbye or even that this is the end. He pretty much says, all right, this is what's going to happen. And he's just gone. He's gone. You there with him on the mountain. He has given you the instruction. And that in the way the Lord being taken up into the cloud, and they just watching, it's like the Lord's just saying, hey, this is your commission. Okay, now go do. I've told you for the last few years of the time that I will go back to my Father and that you will go do greater works. You would go do and be empowered. You will go and build. You will go and harvest and plant. I'm gone. I'm going home now. I'm going back to where I was in the beginning. And of course, the amazing part is, I'm pretty sure if I was there, I don't know about the apostles, but I know if I was there and I saw Jesus going up in the cloud, I would have been like, you just leaving us like that? But at the same time, I would have to challenge myself to say, he is just leaving us like that. He's leaving us to do what he has told us to do. But also as well, I also love that in there, the angel, let's say two robed men, let's say angels, whoever it was, somebody, as the Lord was going, ascending into the cloud to heaven, not you know, the digital cloud, they said, why are you standing here? I mean, yes, this is amazing. I'm pretty sure, you know, I mean, you have to understand the nature of what happened too. Of course, this man that was prophesied, he came to a woman's womb without natural conception. He was born. He lived his life. He died. Not only died, but he came back and he lived. And now he's not even dying again. He's being ascended. There's only one other person in the Bible that's recorded, at least in our canonized Bible, that's recorded for going up to see God without dying. And that is Elijah. And that's going, of course, for those that might be studying the Apocrypha, things like that, you might know about Enoch, okay, as you go. But in this case, the one that I love is Jesus. And Jesus now is ascended into the clouds. He goes up. And the angels of the two white robed men just look down and say, why are you gazing? I mean, what's going on here? I mean, you seem shocked, but he told you he would do this. But I love the promise that was also instilled as well. It's like, why are you standing there staring into heaven? Yes, Jesus has been taken from you into heaven, but someday he will return from heaven in the same way you saw him go. So one day the clouds are going to separate again and the Lord will come back. As crazy as it may sound to us in the natural mind, in the spirit's mind, it bears witness to know that he who is the Holy Spirit that is within us. And that helps us with anticipation. And that's why it's also a good thing, a great thing, a mandated thing for us to know the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit gives us divine anticipation that what we do is not just for today. What we do is with anticipation that he's coming back again. He's going to come back. So our spirits yearn for the day that we see the truth. Some preachers we might know, you know, they get real. It's the last day. But really, we got to be hopeful. Be hopeful. Whenever the day comes is the day we get to see Jesus come back. And the thing is, he's not just coming back, but he's coming back to come for those that are in him. So we need the Holy Spirit to help us live this life full of anticipation, full of power that we can apply. We're not just letting power sit inside of us. We're able to be used to apply this power with boldness, with clarity, with divine pride in who our God is, and just love and do and be and show forth God's glory and tell the story. Be a witness of the good news of Jesus Christ. It's not you that preach. It's not me that preach. It's the Holy Spirit that does it. There's different types of preachers. Why? Because the Holy Spirit understands the Father created us all differently, and we all have different ways of being reached. The Holy Ghost knows someone that needs to be reached by the whooping. The Holy Ghost knows someone needs to be reached by the talking. The Holy Ghost knows that someone needs to be reached by the demonstration in the day-to-day, hands-on, tactile things. The Holy Ghost is a very wise person. The Holy Ghost is someone that we really need to know and rely on and trust the Holy Spirit that he knows what he's doing. Trust the Holy Ghost, even with this channel, that even if no one or not too many people or even a small group watch it today, this video is there and the Holy Spirit will reach the right person at the right time for the right message. The Holy Ghost is an illuminator in this day that as you read the word, you don't understand it. And it's not even your understanding, but it's the Holy Spirit that gives you the understanding. It's the Holy Spirit that gives you the illumination of what the word is saying, what God is saying, what's being applied here. And he helps you be straightened out. He helps you walk this out and you move forth with the anointing and with power to live. Like I emphasized earlier, it's not emphasis for you to live and just walk around, untie my bow tie, or you stole my Honda, Mitsubishi Honda. But it's to live, it's to live, it's to live as your heart gets transformed. Your heart begins to be converted and continue to be transformed by the word of God and the life of God and just living in the spirit of God. And I love the Holy Ghost. I love him.
Me too. I love the Holy Ghost. And I always try to remember this with anything that I do, is that words are not of my own. Because Jesus always made sure that he emphasized that everything that I do is coming from the Father. Everything that I say is coming from the Father. So I always make sure that I remember that with the things that I do. I always remember when I'm preaching or if I'm doing my motivational speaking, this word coming from God. If I'm whatever else I'm doing, these actions, they're coming from the Heavenly Father, because we always got to make sure that we give credit where credit is due. Give credit to the Heavenly Father, because without him, we won't be here. We won't be functioning and we won't be alive. So you got anything else, Brother John?
Nope. All I can say is get to know Jesus and allow Holy Spirit to show you who he is as well. Apply the power. That's going to be my takeaway for today. Apply the power. Don't just have power, and don't just walk in power. You can walk with power, but apply it. Apply it and apply it effectively. Apply your gifts. Apply your talents. But know the Holy Spirit. He's not a new thing. He's not a new person. Not new on the scene. He's always been there. The wisdom of God comes through the Holy Spirit, and we need him. We need him.
Apply the power. Yep, make sure I got that down. Apply the power. Apply the power with another. Apply the power on the side. Apply the power and walk. You got to walk in the power and apply the power. I got a mic right now. Don't make me start preaching.
Oh.
Walk, guys, always remember to not only walk in your power, but to apply the power. This is the end of Bible study. We're going to be going into our closing prayer, which will be done by the Honorable Brother John.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for this time. And in this time, Lord, we honor you, Father. We do honor our Savior, Jesus, and Holy Spirit, special. And forgive me, Lord, as it seems dishonorable, but special shout out to you, Holy Spirit. Thank you for how you just continue to just be the vehicle of which we're able to see Jesus and we're able to see and know the Father. I thank you for the union between all things, between the Father, Son, and the Spirit, and that you will continue to reveal your word to us. Thank you for what we've learned and discussed today. Pray, Lord, that we won't just receive this, but we'll apply it, Lord. Continue to fill us with your Spirit. Empower us and endow us with power, Lord. Pray even, Lord, even as for those that may watch this in the days and years to come, I pray, Holy Spirit, that there will be a hunger that will stir within us to continue to know about you, that will continue to look to you and continue to strive to please you. Forgive us, Father, for all things whenever we try to grieve the Holy Spirit or grieve your heart. But let us be those that continue to just press in you and to just learn of you and learn of ourselves. Help us to walk in our spiritual identity. I thank you even for Ezra, Lord. Thank you for someone that's not afraid to be a voice. Pray that you will continue to increase him, increase his channel, increase his influence, Lord. Increase his capacity for power within him. That, Lord, you will apply him where it is needed and that the power will be dispersed. Same for myself, God. Apply me where I need to be. And each person that is watching this video, Lord, as they need, oh God, as they look to you, as they're in prayer, God, apply the power that's within them, God. I pray that you will recharge our batteries, Lord. Recharge us with your spirit that will walk in you and will continue to do what you have called us to do. We give you thanks and praise and glory and honor in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen, amen, amen. Apply the power. Apply the power. Walk in the power and apply the power. Thank you guys so much for watching another episode of Bible Study. We'll be back next week with Bible Study episode 53. If you haven't already, like, subscribe if you're new. Please turn on your post notification. That way, anytime I upload, you too will send your notification. This is Motivation for Young Christian. I'll see you guys in the next video. Enjoy your weekend. Have a blessed day. Enjoy tomorrow. And make sure that if you don't know and fully understand what tomorrow is, use your Bible, use the internet to be able to learn the significance of that day. I'll see you guys in the next video. Bye.